Coming up this week, off screen.
We meet the girl on the train.
Flee from the greasy strangler.
Declare war on everyone.
Spend some time with the Bloodfather.
Get supersonic with Oasis.
Watch Louis Theroux's Scientology movie.
And look back on the life of the Guv’nor.
All those to come and more, off screen.
This is off screen. Off screen. The latest film news and reviews. This is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
Ooh, welcome to Offscreen. I'm Van Connor.
I am Case Allen.
And before we get to the films, the reviews, the box office top 10, all that juicy news that we love to cover, we got to talk about, Mr. Hugh Jackman. He's made a couple of announcements in the last 24 hours.
I've never heard of him.
You've never heard of him?
Never heard of
him. Oh, he's
Huge Jackman?
Huge Jackman. Huge Action. Huge Action. That's what it is, yeah. He's the Australian who isn't Russell Crowe or Mel Gibson, although Russell Crowe isn't really an Australian, is he? He's from New Zealand.
I would argue that neither's Mel Gibson anymore.
Well, yeah. I think Mel Gibson, if you look into it, was actually born in England.
Was he actually?
I think Mel Gibson was actually born in England, but to Australian parents, but raised in Australia.
I'm gonna verify this on Wikipedia, but let's hear about Huge Action.
Well, he and James Mangold took to Twitter in the last 36 hours and decided to make some announcements. So, the third and final Wolverine movie, which is just finished filming recently, it now has a title. Have you heard this?
I have indeed.
It is going to be Logan. So, yes, I kind of like that. Okay.
Yeah, I think everyone wanted it to be Logan or Old Man Logan. So that,
well, it's based on Old Man Logan.
It's based on that comic book. Yeah.
So the idea now is, well, first of all, James Mangold has then taken to Twitter himself. He's posted a picture of the second page of the script, which has revealed an awful lot. So for one thing, Wolverine's powers are now diminishing. He's going to be in chronic pain and self-medicating through the use of alcohol.
Yeah.
We also got a teaser poster from Mr. Jackson. And Action Jackson. So he's posted the first poster, which has now actually been officially released, and it's a poster of Wolverine's hand with the claws out.
It's all weathered.
Yeah, and a child's hand holding him.
It's a really good poster.
It's a good poster. You think, does this mean X-23 is finally happening?
It's all looking good.
It's all looking good. Yeah. We can't claim that it's not looking brilliant at this point. And it's got Patrick Stewart, and it's got Stephen Merchant, and it's got Richard E. Grant. What could go wrong?
I know.
No Will I Am in this Wolverine outing, because we all know that was the highlight of X-Men Origins.
Wow. Just a point about Mel Gibson.
Go on.
Born in New York.
Oh, New York. Sorry.
New York.
I knew it was New York or London. One or the other. But it's Gillian Anderson who's born in England. That's the one.
There we are.
I think that's why Gillian Anderson seems to keep putting on that British accent and doing British roles.
We should just do an entire podcast special about where people you thought were from, whether or not actually.
Oh, actually, nice segue. We can plug the podcast edition off that.
There we are.
So, obviously the stuff we don't get to fit into the radio edit. This week, The Greasy Strangler and The Guv’nor, we're not going to get to fit those in. So if you want to hear those reviews, more film news, our weekly Moment of Cage, which is always a highlight, just pop along on your local friendly neighbourhood podcast app, whichever one takes your fancy. We're most of them, if not all, I'd say. Tune in, SoundCloud, Deezer,
Acast,
iTunes, naturally. Just go search Off Screen, download the extended podcast edition, and after the end credits, you get a bit more Off Screen. And, a little more goes a long way. So let's do first film of the week, then.
Yeah.
Let's talk about The Father of Blood. Mr. Gibson.
Yeah.
Who's back? Mel Gibson's back, Case. Are you excited about this?
Don't know if I am.
Is it an age thing? You think? Because
it's not an age thing.
No, because I've got 5 years on you. I think
it's definitely not an age thing because I love me some late 80s and early 90s and
obviously Mad Max was the king.
And then comments.
Well, those aside,
you have to put these things aside.
I miss Mel Gibson, the movie star. I do. Every time I see Mel Gibson in an interview or appearing, I miss when Mel Gibson was a movie star. You knew where you stood when Mel Gibson was a movie star.
Yeah, it's just him. Yeah, him as a star has become a taboo.
That's it.
Object.
I don't care about
you
him
can't
as a
just
person.
Be like, yeah, I like him as. A, as
I don't
an
care
actress,
about
so
him
you
as
can't
a
say
person. I want Riggs back, man.
You want Riggs?
I want Riggs. I want Mad Max. You know, I want William Wallace back. You know, I want the man without a face whose name I can't remember back. Forever Young Dude,
I want Forever Young back.
Mr. Forever Young, whatever his name was.
Mr. F. Young. I want Payback.
Yeah.
I want Payback.
Well, actually, funnily enough, you're in for a treat now. because most of the movies we just named, the classics, they all come up here. So this is sort of a comeback film in one sense. It's half comeback film, half retrospective, with a little dash of meta thrown in. So you have Mel Gibson. He plays John Link, a grizzled, burnt-out man who lives in a trailer park, like in Lethal Weapon.
There we are. So there's a link to his past.
So like in Lethal Weapon. And then his daughter comes to visit him, and there are people chasing her, like in Edge of Darkness.
I get that.
So then they go on the run together, like in Bird on a Wire. And then he goes all violent and killing spree, like in Payback. And, yeah, so every Mel Gibson movie comes up, he has to protect his daughter from a bunch of deviant criminals who are out for... I don't really particularly remember what the motivation behind it all is. There's a robbery gone bad at the very beginning of the film. They're after her, and Link has to basically violate his parole to protect his wayward, estranged daughter, with whom he wants nothing more but to reconnect. Here's a clip.
Dad?
I'm here. Well, where the hell are you?
I know that it's been a really long time. I just...
Well, just stay on the line. Where you been, kid?
I left home a while ago.
Yeah, I know. You scared a lot of people.
I need cash fast.
Just enough so I can get lost because I'm
dead. I'm like this fly that's about to get splattered on a windshield.
Does that make any sense?
And he's using a telephone, like in Ransom. So
that is such a loose link.
Yes, but it is Link.
John Link.
But okay, so first of all, I really dug this. Didn't quite expect it to be as good as it was. I thought this is going to be one of those sort of... Mel Gibson is a star sort of comparable in terms of his modern status to someone like Schwarzenegger, where they've not particularly gone away, but we've stopped giving them movie star status.
Yeah, well, I was just about to compare this to when Schwarzenegger was in The Last Stand. Yeah.
Exactly that. And because it's a very desert-based film and very much a grimy action film, there is a natural comparison point. But what you've got is a film that knows it's a Mel Gibson film, that really wants to give him everything he's always done so well. He's on fine form. He's still got the action chops. He's still got that grizzled comedy thing that he used to do, that sort of, I'm like a slightly buffer Clint Eastwood kind of a routine. Erin Moriarty as the daughter is something of a revelation. She's really good. She was in Jessica Jones. She was the girl that Jessica Jones was trying to defend all the way through that series. Hope Schlottman, if you want the actual name. She's great. She's something of a discovery. However, MVP trophy goes to Mr. William H. Macy. Bill Macy turns up, got the mustache, got the slightly long scraggly hair. He is a trailer.
Well, he's filming Shameless, so he's always got that.
Yeah, of course. He's the trailer park comic relief sidekick. Because the movie has something of a fugitive road movie kind of an aspect to it, he's obviously not in it very long because, you know, they had kind of have to depart him for obvious reasons. I would see more of him. His comedic repertoire with Gibson is terrific. Really had a lot of fun with it. It was a stripped down, down to the wire, gritty, bare bones action thriller that gave you everything you wanted from the Mel Gibson of days gone by. He's apparently got more on the way. I'm very, very glad because after this, I want more of him. I want Mel Gibson back.
We're going to see him as a director again very, very soon.
We are. Hacksaw Ridge is next.
Yeah.
We have got some film news with him in later, but we need to cover the box office top 10 in pretty much record time.
Number 10.
M.S. Dhoni, The Untold Story. And I don't know anything about it, so it's going to remain untold.
It is kind of untold. I've not seen it either. I believe it's a cricket biopic. I have not had the pleasure.
Number 9.
Bad Moms is still here.
It's still hanging in there. This has got to be hitting DVD before long, surely.
Must be. It's been out for a good couple of months
six,
now.
Six weeks, something like that. It's only about three or four away from DVD release.
Yeah.
Funny, doesn't quite make the most of its concept, doesn't quite make a grand point. Mila Kunis and Kristen Bell and Catherine Hahn, good team up, though. I quite like that. Christina Applegate as, salivating villain suburban villain type character is about as much fun as you'd expect. I laughed a few times. I really enjoyed it.
Number 8.
Don't Breathe.
Have you had the pleasure yet, still?
No, because I'm a student now, so I'm not allowed to do anything except work.
Well, when you get the pleasure, you will love every minute of it. It is.
I can't wait. I honestly can't wait to see it.
It is. It's like Hitchcock does torture porn. The whole Saw hostile genre. Imagine that by way of Hitchcock, and you've got Don't Breathe, which I love. I think Stephen Lang's great in it. It's got my boy Dylan Minnette in it as well.
My boy.
My boy, yeah. Dog. My boy.
Number 7.
Kubo and the Two Strings.
You love this.
I love this so much.
I do as well. So I'm glad it's hanging in there. I'm glad it's still getting some traction.
Yeah, it seems to have found an audience, and that makes me happy.
For an original property, I think that's something, in this day and age, really impressive.
Number six.
Finding Dory. This already had an audience.
this had an audience, yeah. And then that audience grew up and bred a new audience.
And then had kids.
Yeah, they bred a new audience, and that new audience are coming back with the old audience, and that's why this season has been around for 10 weeks now.
Yeah, and this will be on DVD and Blu-ray soon.
It's got to be, surely.
Yeah.
This is going to be like Jungle Book, where it only leaves the top 10 for the sake of getting a DVD release.
Exactly, to just make more money.
It's only got, I believe, one more week, by the way, before it beats the Jungle Book.
Really?
Jungle Book hung in 11 weeks.
What is that, the record for this year? I've not been paying attention as far as...
I'm not sure, actually. We'll have to look into that.
We'll look into that, yeah.
Because Captain America Civil War, I think, didn't scratch 10.
We'll definitely look into it before the end of the year.
Before the end of the year, we will find out. When the end of year stats come in, I think it'll be an interesting one.
With the latest film news and reviews, this is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
And we're back. So, I was going to say first review. It's not now, is it?
It's the second. The girl on the train,
which is this is the big advertised one this week.
Yeah. So, are we going to call this Gone Girl on the Train, or is that what everyone else is calling it?
Do you know
it?
What? Funnily enough, that is exactly what I've been calling it, Gone Girl on the Train. Because this has been built from the ground up, and it's very obvious from the minute you start watching it. Built from the ground up, let's follow the Gone Girl template. In that way that we always talk about Three Musketeers was with Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves.
Yeah,
where
absolutely.
Let's replicate that formula, and we'll just take another classic.
Well, this film was going to come out 18 months after the book came out, which is insane.
It's almost like Gone Girl was a huge hit, and they thought, what else we got?
Funny about what else has got the word girl in the title, whatever book has...
And then we got the girl with all the gifts, and it's like, this is just getting silly now. Okay, so this stars Emily Blunt as Rachel Watson. She is a woman who has gone through a broken marriage. Her marriage has collapsed due to infertility, and her husband's then successive infidelity as well, husband being Justin Theroux. Justin Theroux has now settled into a new life with his wife, Ms. Rebecca Ferguson, your lady there, and they have had a child.
So
I know. Wow. And she's in Blonde in this one, by the way, for a very specific reason that I will get to. He's now got a child with his new wife. Emily Blunt is not handling it so well. It's been 2 years. She's now unemployed. She's an alcoholic. She's, you know, down to her last frayed nerve. And she's basically finding solace in commuting to and from New York every day and sort of staring out the window at what were her old neighbours before. And they are a married couple played by Hayley Bennett and Luke Evans. One morning, she spots Hayley Bennett with another man. And then... almost as if somehow linked, Hayley Bennett mysteriously disappears shortly afterwards. And, well, in what can only be described as the worst timing ever, Emily Blunt then wakes up after a drunken bender, covered in blood, no memory of what happened the night before, and has to basically find out not only what happened to Hayley Bennett, whatever happened to this young, seemingly perfect wife, but also what her own involvement in it actually is. Here's a clip.
I'm here because I woke up covered in blood, and I had bruises all over my arm, and it's usually from when I've fallen and someone's helped me up. My husband, he used to tell me what I'd done the night before, and I learned when you wake up like that, you just say you're sorry. You just say you're sorry for what you did, and you're sorry for who you are, and you're never going to do it again. But you do it again.
So the short version of this is that Emily Blunt's terrific. The film is not quite so terrific. Right, it never quite comes together. It really, really wants to be Gone Girl. And you've got Tate Taylor, who did The Help and Get On Up, which I always forget he did Get On Up. But The Help is a movie I absolutely adore. Get On Up, I think, was underrated. Had a great Chadwick Boseman performance. But they are both of them are quite, you know, lighthearted tonally. I mean, The Help dealt with some quite serious stuff, but it did it in a lighthearted way. This is Tate Taylor basically going for David Fincher terrain, and he's trying to replicate the style of Gone Girl. You know, that very cool, very, teal lighting kind of...
Everything's blue.
Everything's blue. Well, I think teal specifically for some reason, because it's like teal and orange, but just no orange.
No orange.
Remember when every movie was teal and orange about 10 years ago?
Yeah, thanks for that, Steven Soderbergh.
Yeah, and Michael Bay, stop. because he's still doing it.
I love that all Soderbergh films just a little bit orange.
But yeah, so he's gone for that cool, everything is, you know, dark grey tiles and teal lighting. And you think, okay, you know what? I appreciate that this is a notable step up momentum-wise for him. Great. The problem is, the script's rubbish, for one thing. It's written by Erin Cressida Wilson, who did Secretary. Mm. Did Secretary, then did Chloe as well. So she's clearly got a thing about the adult, well, her adult content, we'll say. Because I wouldn't call Secretary a thriller.
Is that the Amanda Seyfried?
The Amanda Seyfried, Liam Neeson
Julianne Moore, yeah.
That I've only seen one scene from. Yes, that exact one. And we all know what scene it was, let's be honest.
Scene in the library, right? Where we're just reading books.
Yeah, that's totally what it is. Yep. Yeah, that's my love of Julianne Moore. It was totally satiated by that one scene. Anyway, going back to point. Erin Cressida Wilson has tried to perfect the Gone Girl balance of here is a compelling mystery thriller and here is a character-driven drama. The problem is, Gone Girl had that balance perfect. Girl on the Train, not so much. It basically has all these mystery thriller elements that don't add up to much. When you get to the ultimate conclusion of the film, it makes no sense whatsoever. You're thinking, why is the film purposefully highlighted this when it adds nothing to the ultimate, very predictable conclusion? And it is a just awfully predictable conclusion. Very, very, just irritatingly predictable. Having said that, Emily Blunt's great. It's nice to see Luke Evans playing something other than a sort of action man-y role for a change, or fantasy action, or something like that. This is quite a flawed, interesting human character. Hayley Bennett, you know what? She's still the discovery. She's still interesting after Magnificent Seven. She's got something of an early Jennifer Lawrence thing going on, although she seems to be a bit older. However, there is a flaw, and you're not going to like it, Case. It's Miss Janey.
I knew you were going to say that, and I knew she was going to be in it, because it's a Tate Taylor film.
Yeah, there's that.
So yeah, she's basically the John Ratzenberg to his Pixar.
Exactly.
Yeah, she's in all of his films.
The problem I've got here, she seems to have been directed towards delivering the performance with smugness rather than self-righteousness. And she's the investigating detective. And the problem is, you've got Alison Janney. Use her properly. And if she did self-righteous, it would have worked perfectly. The problem is, it being smug, it kind of undermines the plot a little bit. And I'm sure that might be from the book or whatever, but it's wrong in this context.
Although, I don't know how much that's been taken directly from the book, because apparently Emily Blunt's character, the main character, nothing like how she has in the book.
That's the thing. I like how Emily Blunt's played it. She's delivered a very flawed character and made her quite a sympathetic and engaging lead. The fact that the whole story has been transplanted from the UK to the US isn't really much of an issue. For some reason, Emily Blunt is still British, though. It's never quite explained. But she's just randomly British for no reason. Doesn't quite come together. Doesn't go off the rails completely, to go with the title pun. But it really is only as good as Emily Blunt, and she's left to carry this thing. It's not Gone Girl. And frankly, you'd be better off actually taking the ticket money you would have spent on this and just going and buying the Blu-ray of Gone Girl and watching that and seeing this done properly. Because it does feel like a cash-in, and you want something a lot more from it. I was let down, to be honest. It's not an awful film. It's just, in fact, it would have been more interesting if it were awful. That's the problem. It's not engaging. It's not much to talk about with it. Yeah, it's not discussion worthy. This is not like Gone Girl, where you go to work the next day and you talk about it over the water cooler.
Yeah.
I mean, we all were like, oh my God, how good was Rosamund Pike in that movie? You know, and like, oh, how wrong was Neil Patrick Harris? Gone Girl was awesome. This is not. So, a bit off topic, some film news for you. Do you know Coalition Studios, the video game studio?
No. I feel like I might know the
news. You might know the news. Yeah. Right. They've revealed that Microsoft and Universal are teaming up to do a Gears of War movie.
Yeah.
This is like one of the biggest video game franchises in the world.
Yeah, I'm surprised it hasn't been optioned sooner.
They've tried for years, because right. Billy Ray was going to do it at one point. It's Billy Ray. And who are the other ones? There's been a couple over the years that have tried to get this off the ground. It's never happened. Apparently, now it will. So we shall see. It's got one of the producers of Rise of the Planet of the Apes and one of the producers Ted on it.
Wow, swings around about.
Really, just cover all your bases there. Right, okay, quick review then. Let's talk about the War on Everyone, which is the latest from John Michael McDonough, Like you asked me, which McDonough is it? It's the one who did Calvary and The Guard, not the brother who did In Bruges
and Seven Psychopaths.
Seven Psychopaths. So you've got two corrupt cops, and they are corrupt as hell. We haven't got a clip for this, by the way, because the film is so drenched in profanity, you literally cannot find a coherent clip. I tried bleeping a clip. It doesn't work. You can't follow the clip. So they are two cops. They are basically well and truly versed in the idea of squeezing the criminal element of their neighborhood. They will bribe, they will lie, cheat, steal, do anything. They'll plant evidence, they will do anything they have to keep their streets clean. They are on the side of the angels, behaving like devils, for lack of a better term. Now, the cops are played by Michael Peña and Alexander Skarsgård, and this wheeling and dealing lands them in hot water one day when they cross paths with a British Lord Mangan, played by Theo James, who is this sort of, you know, suave, sophisticated British criminal. And he unleashes just this tirade of fury, and what you get is basically a Shane Black homage. This is the Kiss Kiss Bang Bang thematic follow-up that The Nice Guys wasn't. I know you're a big fan of Nice Guys, you like it more than me. This kind of, in a strange way, feels more in step with Kiss Kiss Bang Bang than The Nice Guys. Alexander Skarsgård continues his trend of, I'm not just a pretty face, I am a younger, hunkier version of my dad. And really, it really does work. It does work, and it works very well in this context. Michael Peña, though, doesn't get an awful lot to do that we haven't seen him do three or four times in the last year. I mean, there are elements of Ant-Man in here. There's a little bit of his Martian role. There's just requisite Michael Peña. Tessa Thompson's in there as, well, the token girl, yet she's not saddled with a love interest role. She actually gets a little bit more to do.
Oh, cool.
As well as some surprisingly effective chemistry with Alexander Skarsgård. And Tessa Thompson's someone else who's shot up a lot in the last year.
She has, yeah. Just to intersect with a tiny little bit of film news, she is on track to be in the female lead for the Han Solo film.
Yeah, I heard this.
Yeah, it's between her and Zoe Kravitz and maybe a couple other people, but that's who we're looking at right now.
Female lead Han Solo. I could see that.
I could totally see that, yeah.
Well, we've got her in Thor next year, haven't we?
We have, can't wait, yeah.
In Thor Ragnarok.
Valkyrie, she's playing.
I'm looking forward to this. Yeah. Theo James, you know, enjoyable performance as the villain. Not quite an interesting character, though. You feel like they could have done more with it. The joy of it, though, is in the script. The joy is in just the sheer vulgar, crass, crude, dark-hearted nature of it. It is funny. It is violent. It is over the top. It is excessive, and it is visceral. It is well enough shot with enough sort of frenetic energy from McDonough. The big problem with it is it's going to be a very divisive film. It's divisive really as regards its tone. To put this in context for you, it is a movie that opens with the two cops in a car chasing down a mime, and Michael Peña saying, if you mow down a mime, does he make a sound? Right, if that kind of thing amuses you, you're in for a great time with the film.
Well, I laughed
exactly.
at that.
You laughed
I
at
chuckled
that.
At that.
You probably will love this. Yeah. You're a Peña fan anyway.
I am a Peña fan.
So you're going to love this, because he gets his time to shine. If you're not into really, really sinister, really bloody, really just, you know, violence-thirsty comedy, you're not going to get on board with this, and it's not really even worth trying. It is very divisive in that way.
With the latest film news and reviews, this is Offscreen.
You can be my wingman anytime.
You can be my wingman, Case, anytime.
Oh, cheers.
I know.
Cheers, Goose.
You're just not a Top Gun fan. I will never understand
it. I'm not.
I will convert you, you know.
Right, I'd rather watch Hot Shots.
That's a tough call. I do love Hot Shots. Although I prefer Hot Shots Part 2 to Hot Shots
1. I might as well, actually, yeah.
Yeah, Hot Shots Part 2 is one of those that's actually gotten more culturally relevant as time's gone on. But thank you very much, US of A. Right, so let's finish the box office top 10 for the week and get that done and dusted.
Number 5.
Supersonic.
Oh, well, we can't really talk about Supersonic because that's our next review. So we'll leave that.
Yeah, stick around.
Stick around. Don't look back in anger. We'll be back.
Number 4.
Magnificent Seven.
Now, have you seen this one?
No.
No?
No.
Do you have any interest in seeing it out of interest?
I do.
Out of interest, I do. But is your interest based on like a childhood love of The Magnificent Seven, the original, or... Or is it just
a little bit? A little bit. And this Fuqua film, and Denzel and Chris Pratt, and Vinny D'Onofrio and Ethan Hawke.
Okay, so
yeah. It's the cast, it's the classic story, it's that. I like a Western as well. I watch a rubbish Western.
Well, that's it. I mean, to be honest, yeah. This does feel like an Antoine Fuqua Western, but less like The Magnificent Seven. It feels gritty and dour and... Mm. I mean, don't get me wrong, the action scenes are fantastic because it's a Fuqua film. And if Olympus Has Fallen has taught us anything, it's that Antoine Fuqua can do action and head-stabbing fun.
It's a head-stabbing good time for all.
It's a head-stabbing good time for the whole family. But Magnificent Seven, not so much a good time for the whole family. It's one that will make your granddad roll his eyes and go, was better in my day. And frankly, he'd be right to.
Number three.
Deepwater Horizon, which I really liked. I thought it was like Irwin Allen for the Black Hawk Down generation. Mark Wahlberg's a lot of fun in it. Peter Berg does a little action flair in there, sort of a Michael Bay with a bit of conscience to him. And Kurt Russell is pretty badass.
Number two.
Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. I can't believe I said that without stuttering.
In one go.
Yeah,
well done, Case.
Thank you very much.
So, no, I liked this. And I am aware that me liking a Tim Burton film is one of the signs of the apocalypse.
Yeah,
I'm
just saying some pigs flying right now.
Pigs flying. Yeah. Hell is freezing over. Yeah. But I liked Big Eyes as
and
well.
And Donald Trump is going to be president.
Well, we know that one of those is actually true. But it will happen. But anyway. But yeah, two for two, because I liked Big Eyes. This plays like Tim Burton's X-Men. And it's got Ava Green as its would-be Professor X, and it really works. I liked it. I liked Arza Butterfield as a lead. I thought like we said before, he's one of those actors, young actors, who goes away for a couple of years, comes back, reminds you he's brilliant, and then goes away again. Mm. And you'd kind of rather that than he keeps churning them out and occasionally gets them wrong. But between this and Ender's Game, he's sorted for me for a while. But I like that Tim Burton has distanced himself slightly from this material. Mm. The biggest complaint you can have with it, arguably, is Samuel L. Jackson's kind of phoning this in, because it's what we're used to from him now. But other than that, I really enjoyed it.
Number one.
She's still here. Bridget Jones's Baby.
Oh, that baby is still going. And frankly, is well about as amusing as a regular human baby, which is, I'm sure it's, you know, great to the people that want a human baby around. I don't so much. But...
Yeah, it's kind of getting to a point where the filmmakers are like that really annoying, overbearing parent that's had a kid for a while, and we're just like, look at our baby. And it's like, we have. It's great.
But that's fine. The thing. Bridget Jones is, it's funny enough. It's not groundbreaking. It's a vast improvement on the second one. It's not a patch on the first. If you're a fan, you're going to enjoy it. If not, it's not really going to convert you. And it is about 5 years out of date, and it feels it all the way through. Having said that, you know, Bridget's back. She's as likable as she ever was, I suppose. Has got Sarah Soleimani and Emma Thompson to steal the film, though. So, yeah, can't really complain. You know, there is some fun in there. And, well, I just think the Ed Sheeran joke's a bit dated, for one thing. Yeah, and the Tinder gag and the...
Yeah, despite the fact that apparently the film takes place 5 years ago.
Does it take place 5 years ago?
I don't know.
Because
this
if that's...
This is just what we've...
Yeah, there's certain internet developments and modern iPhones and things like that, that you just think, well, this is quite clearly now. So, yeah. Doesn't make a whole heap of sense, but you know what? It's fine. We'll let it go. Let's talk about Nicholas Holt for a minute. Have you heard about his new job?
Yes.
I'm very happy about this.
It sounds pretty good.
This
sounds interesting.
One of your favourite actors in this, isn't it? Mr. Shannon? Mm-hmm. So Michael Shannon and Benedict Cumberbatch are going to star in The Current War, which is a very clever title for one thing, which is the story of Thomas Edison and George Westinghouse and their rivalry for who's going to be the dominant, you know, creator of electricity. Because was it Edison who wanted direct current and Westinghouse wanted alternating current?
I think so, yeah.
Well, Nicholas Holt's going to join now.
And who's he going to be playing?
Nikola Tesla, the inventor of the car.
Yes, he's going to be following the great footsteps of David Bowie.
Yes, because that is a tough act to follow. Once Bowie's done it, why would you even try? Unless, of course, you're Michael Sheen. But yeah, because that was fun in Tron Legacy. But so he's going to play Nikola Tesla, who famously worked with Thomas Edison for years and then left for... I've never really been quite clear. He left and sold his patents to Westinghouse. So, you know, further increasing their rivalry. This actually sounds like it could be really interesting. Mm. But Benedict Cumberbatch as Thomas Edison, that's going to be amazing.
Michael Shannon.
Doctor Strange v. Zod. I'm sure this is going to really pan out. So let's talk then about, it's not really the big documentary of the week. And it's only one evening screening that you could go to, and that's passed.
But even so, it's number five in the
It's number five in the top ten. So, Supersonic, which is the latest documentary from the team behind Amy and Senna.
Yes.
And this is the directorial debut of one of those movies' producers, Matt Whitecross.
Yeah.
And, of course, chronicles the rise, but not the fall, of Oasis. And this is a very, very key sticking point, not the fall.
Not the fall.
It chronicles the origins of Oasis, how they formed, so the Gallagher brothers' childhood years as well, how Oasis formed, and goes all the way up to their kind of iconic their two-night set at Nebworth in 1996, which was just after the release of What's the Story, Morning Glory, because it was during the sort of promotional high of that movie. It was about a year after, but the album was still dominating sort of pop culture. And yeah, so it's done in the style of Amy. So there's no talking heads, it's disembodied voices over a lot of archival footage. Very stylized, very slick looking, very in your face. Here's a clip of Noel Gallagher talking about how he joined Oasis and dispelling one of the most famous stories about the band.
To hear your own stuff played back, it was really a mega moment. And then it went nowhere for 2 years. So, I mean, there is the myth that I kicked open the rehearsal room door to the theme tune from The Good, The Bad and The Ugly and said, everybody stop what they're doing, I am here to make us all millionaires. You know, there wasn't that at all, you know what I mean?
No, the truth is he got on his hands and knees and said, listen, I'll do anything, just please let me be in your band. I said, get up off your hands and knees, son. You're all right, you can do it. I think I've got a picture of it somewhere.
So you can get a sense of the humour that's going to run through this.
Yeah.
It is a very funny film. They do naturally. The Gallagher brothers have a sense of humour in their own distinct ways. Noel is very self-aware, very deadpan, very dry.
Yeah.
Liam is...
in his own world.
Yes, in his own world. Delusional would be another way of putting it.
He is all around the world.
He is all around the world. But thankfully, the film doesn't particularly look back in anger. I couldn't resist. I'm sorry.
All right. Fine.
The film doesn't quite look back in anger. In fact, the weird thing about the film is it doesn't have much in the way of historical perspective beyond its very limited window. It doesn't, for instance, mention at any point that they ever split up. It doesn't mention why they split up. There is a passing reference to the fact the Gallagher brothers don't have a relationship anymore.
So some might say that it's actually quite a sheltered look at the band.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, I mean, there is a sense of acquiescence to it all.
Mm.
I mean, underneath the sky, it does seem like it could be a lot more in depth than it is. It does slide away into a sense of
what you're trying to say is it casts no shadow.
It casts no shadow, indeed. Yeah. If you're a fan of Oasis, there's a lot in there that you won't know. A surprising amount.
It's the master plan.
It is the master plan.
Yeah.
there is a surprising amount you will learn. There is a story about Oasis' first American gig that will just have your jaw on the floor.
What's the story?
What, Morning Glory? Right. Well, during their first gig in Hollywood, they thought they were doing coke. It turned out to be crystal meth. and it created this ripple effect of absolute chaos, which kind of destroyed the idea of Oasis in America in one sense. It doesn't have the heft of something like Amy, though, because there isn't a grand tragic story to it, because they've chosen not to cover that aspect of the story. They've chosen to end long before it gets to the really interesting stuff about Oasis. And we all know that the more interesting stuff about Oasis is the relationship between Liam and Noel, and when that actually disintegrated. The problem is this stops long before the disintegration point. So you've got the build-up to a terrific documentary that doesn't then deliver that terrific documentary. What you get is a good time and some really informative anecdotes about Oasis. There is a story about, for instance, Noel went walkabout in the US and shacked up with a girl in San Francisco who he now doesn't remember and who turned out to be the entire inspiration for Talk Tonight. Didn't know that. Interesting story, though, right?
Yeah.
Learned that All Around the World was actually one of the very first Oasis songs. It just...
Really?
Yeah, just didn't see the light of day.
The third album.
Didn't see the light of day until the third album. And it sounded exactly the same as well. That was the really, really strange part. Because there is a surprising amount of recorded footage of young Oasis. I didn't realise for one thing that Liam Gallagher was only about 19 when the band started.
Yeah, I did know that.
I didn't think that because he looked about 30, so...
Have you seen him now?
Well, he looks about 40, so...
That's accurate.
Exactly.
I think he looks older.
What's the line from Will and Grace? It's like the OC with 25-year-old kids and 35-year-old parents. But Yeah, but I'll say, I did like it. I didn't think it had anywhere near the heft of something like Amy, because Amy told a complete story. This really doesn't. And you do feel like you're leaving the cinema having not been told the full picture, not been shown the full picture. Mm. And that's probably never quite overcomes. It's stylish as hell, though, and it has taken its cues from Amy, and it does show. And it is a very likeable, very engaging, very romping documentary. If you're a fan of Oasis, you're in for a great time. If you are curious about Oasis, you're going to get shown an awful lot. You're going to learn a fair bit, and you may actually become a fan as a result. The problem is, it's not the complete story, and you do come away wanting that, and it never quite gets over it.
With the latest film news and reviews, this is Offscreen, the on-screen radio show.
And we're back and dancing. Who doesn't love a bit of that Star Wars disco music? Did you ever check out the Star Wars Kinect dancing game, by the way?
No. It's still on my list of Kinect dancing games.
When we're done, I'll show it you on YouTube. It's actual disco dancing with Lando and Han.
Beautiful.
You're in for a whale of a time. But let's get the final review of the week out of the way, which is also another documentary, My Scientology Movie.
Yeah. Right,
Louis Theroux : My Scientology Movie, yeah. Which is a very deceptive, very yet clever title. Because presumably, you've not seen the movie, I'm guessing.
Not yet, no.
So you're presumably expecting a documentary about Scientology, right?
Mm.
Right, it's not that.
It's a documentary
not that
about Louis.
No, it's not that either. It's actually something closer to Mark Thomas's work. Do you know Mark Thomas, the comedian activist? He does.
A little bit, yeah.
He pulls stunts to bait people to prove a political point. Right. I've seen a couple of his live shows. He's a lot of fun. This is Louis Theroux doing something quite similar. What he's done is, as the film opens, he tells us about Scientology very briefly, and then he says, I've been on at them for years. I've been asking them, can I have some access? Can I do a documentary about Scientology? I want to see what makes this organization tick. So the church, being what it is, has always turned him down. So he's decided to take it a step further. He's gone and got one of Scientology's most famous, most well-known escapees, Marty Rathbun, who was a real high up in the, like an enforcer for the church, enforcer slash PR man, who is guilty of some absolutely terrible things, as we learn over the course of this. And he and Louis set up, using actually publicly released videos and footage from the church, they set up a movie. And they reenact, for the purposes of a movie, all of these famous scenes from the existence of Scientology. They cast Tom Cruise. They cast the church's leader, David Miscavige. They cast Marty. But in doing this movie, they do it sort of behind closed doors. So all the Church of Scientology knows is that Louis Theroux is making what seems to be a fictional movie about Scientology. So you can only guess what then happens. The church decide to go after Louis and Marty Rathbun. What you have are people following them in innocuous vehicles. You have security guards and higher-ups from the Sea Org accosting them on the street, saying, you can't film here. This is a private road. It's a public road. They're very, very adamant about this road. They have a real thing about this road. And Marty Rathbun gets his life absolutely threatened with upheaval. They make comments about his adopted son. He's accosted at the airport. And we actually get this recorded through a BlackBerry camera. He's got it in his pocket. And there are three members of the Church of Scientology basically just walking up to him in the middle of an airport, telling him he's worthless and what a waste he is. And it's an absolutely harrowing story. Behind it all, of course, is Louis Theroux and his well-patented, his style of aloofness, which of course is not the way to call it.
Yeah. Pretty accurate.
Did you know, by the way, he's Justin Theroux's cousin?
I did know that. In fact, I was going to segue that myself, but you've beat me to it. So.
I'm sorry. I didn't.
Touché.
I didn't know.
It's all right.
It's something I didn't know until the other day. But
yeah, no, interesting, wasn't it?
Yeah, and Melissa and Jenny McCarthy are cousins. Didn't know that either.
I knew that as well.
No, didn't know that either.
This is another future podcast special.
Yeah, and Robbie and Stephen Amell.
Yeah, are relations of the rich and famous. Which
call exactly. But yeah, so. Louis Theroux versus the Church of Scientology. We have a trailer clip here.
Scientology.
A religion created by a sci-fi writer, run by a mysterious leader, David Miscavige.
So this is my chance to experience Scientology firsthand.
You need to leave.
How are you doing, Mr. Squirrel?
You guys are trespassing.
Got anything to say?
It's okay, we have a permit.
Why are you here?
He's right behind us now.
We have their attention.
Why are they doing this?
It's just not like any church that you could think of.
Gradually, I realised you were never going to let me in.
So, Louis Theroux fans can rejoice. I presume you're a Louis Theroux fan.
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah.
Louis Theroux fans can rejoice because he has brought the style that we love him for to the screen. He's brought it successfully. What is less successful? Because the actual gimmick, the concept, as I've just laid it out for you, that does work. But the problem is, you want Louis Theroux to do what he does best, which is to do the straight documentary with that style of aloofness. Obviously, that's not entirely his fault, because you kind of feel like Alex Gibney kind of pulled the rug out from under him with this one, because Alex Gibney had Going Clear, which was that documentary. It was a straight documentary. And once you've seen that about Scientology, you kind of don't need to go any further with it. This does work in that Mark Thomas sense, in the let's pull a stump, let's bait them kind of a sense. And, you know, Louis's always entertaining to watch. There are some moments in the film that will absolutely hilarious, that will have you rolling around the aisles. The problem is, you do feel like you've been denied something, in that way that the Oasis documentary didn't give you a complete picture. This kind of has a similar feeling in... when Louis Theroux is coming to the big screen, I want him to do Louis Theroux. I want a Louis Theroux documentary, not so much a stunt. Mm. Having said that, it is harrowing and hilarious in equal measure, and you're never uninterested. Yeah. Like you've got to give it that. It's a gripping story. It is intriguing. It has a cinematic sort of feel to it. It does feel like he's upped his game with the sort of shift to the bigger format. You look like you're going to ask me something.
I wasn't so much going to ask, but rather state something. I think I would like to see him do something other than his usual documentaries, because he has been quite consistently doing the same thing for years and years and years. I'm not saying that's a bad thing, because I've been a fan of Louis for as long as I can remember. But we always get them like one every 6 months or...
Yeah,
but there was one on Sunday. There was a recap of the Jimmy Savile.
Thank you for reminding me. It's like a sequel, wasn't it?
I've not seen it yet.
No, I need to watch that. Thank you for reminding me.
That's going to be in a similar style, and it might be interesting now that this is a change of format to see him do something a little bit further apace.
Did you know that Louis Theroux's Complete Works is one of the most requested home releases ever?
Really?
Because they've never released the complete Louis Theroux collection. It's one of the most requested things ever.
I didn't know a lot of people that watch them on Netflix.
Yeah, again, they are the weird weekends, aren't they?
Weird weekends, and there's the LA Stories on there as well. And,
So that's the thing. I think you'd like it. I think you'd be blown away by it. I think it does tick the box of let's get Louis Theroux on the big screen, and I like
it
for that.
A lot of it's just his presence.
It is. He's an enjoyable presence, isn't he?
Yeah.
But that's it. It's not the big be-all, end-all Louis Theroux cinematic documentary that we quite hoped for. But, you know, I'll take it. I still enjoyed it. I liked it. I'm intrigued by it. I want to see him do more big screen documentaries, though. I would like something more straight informative, though, than here's a chronicle of how these people actually behave.
God, I'd love him to do a US election one.
Imagine that. We have got a documentary in a couple of weeks called You Got Trumped.
Really?
Which I know nothing about. I'm intrigued by that. But it's not Film of the Week, anyway.
Okay.
We're not giving it Film of the Week. I'm going to give that to good old Mel. Welcome back, Mel. You were gone far too long. It's good to have you back.
Now, don't screw it up.
Don't screw it up. Bloodfather is... I'm giving Film of the Week, too. But So, your boy, Mr. Hanks, the Jimmy Stewart of his generation, he's back next week.
And what is he back in?
He's back in a Dan Brown adaptation, because those are always so much fun with their skydiving priests and self-flagellating Paul Bettany's. But,
I would love us ones more if that's just what it was called. Skydiving Priest. Featuring Tom Hanks.
Ewan McGregor is the Skydiving Priest. Skydiving Pope, wasn't he? He was the Pope, actually.
He was a smoking Pope in the last one.
He was the literally a smoking Pope who's ever lived.
The Popiest Pope.
The Pope is the buffest Pope. So Inferno's next week. Andy Samberg's got an animated film next week.
Yeah, Stokes.
Storks.
Do you know who's directed that?
No.
Nicholas Stoller.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow, so director of I Love You Man and Sarah Marshall. And,
yeah.
Wow, I didn't know that. They've kept that fairly quiet. Mm. It's also got Key and Peele in, I believe, as well.
It has two wolves.
And I think Kelsey Grammer somewhere? Is he?
Yeah, he plays, like, a boss stork.
Okay, as you do. Yeah, that's who you get Frasier to play, totally. We've also got Kate play Christine. I don't know anything about that one.
No.
And of course, a near 3 hour long movie starring Shia LaBeouf, because that's going to end well. American Honey is next week. So it's a fairly quiet week. 4 films.
Oh my God. What are we going to talk about after that?
I know. Podcast Extra is just going to be us just, you know, shoot the breeze.
Do you know what? We'll use some of the leftover Oasis puns that we didn't use today. We'll put them in there.
Well, you know, I am a walrus and all. So. Is that even an
how subtle that reference was? It was a cover.
It's a cover, but it's on the master plan, isn't it?
So, yeah, I think so. It's on the master plan. Yeah, that's so, B-sides and rarities album, yeah, isn't it?
It is weird to me that the Oasis' best album is their B-sides album. It's kind of a weird one, that one.
Whatever.
But, okay, so we've got all those to come and more next week off-screen. This has been a Candy Store production for On Screen. I've been Van Connor.
I've been, as always, Case Allen.
And we leave you this week with news of Lee Daniels' upcoming project, his most personal one to date, a musical about the life of Lee Daniels. We'll see you next week.
Just show me the way to get out of here, and I'll be on my way.
You've been listening to Off Screen. For more news and reviews, visit onscreenfilm.com.
Podcast extras then, Mr. Allen. So two reviews to do this week, both begin with G. So, yeah.
And then next week we have...
None of that. And... Next week we've got so much more fun. So, let's do some film news, because I don't want to get to the Greasy Strangler.
I want to talk about this Lee Daniels.
The Lee Daniels thing.
Yeah, because he dropped out of doing Richard Pryor.
He did, biopic. Yeah, he did.
Yeah, which was giving up to just be...
Be awesome.
Amazing. It sounded incredible. Well, he dropped out?
I don't know.
How full of yourself you got to be to make a film about yourself over making a film about Richard Pryor?
Well, let's be honest. We could joke that it's going to be called Lee Daniels the Musical. The thing is...
Lee Daniels presents a film about Lee Daniels.
He's just arrogant enough to do it, though.
Yeah.
Like, it's actually a possibility with him. But, apparently the genesis of it comes from his exact words. Well, I've had a pretty interesting life story. Like... We all think that about ourselves, but it'd be really boring to watch for someone else.
Yeah.
His story is his father was a police officer, an abusive police officer, who was killed in the line of duty. Prior to that, his father smacked him around to, as he called it, beat the gay out of him. He then went to work as at an agency for nurses, a nurse hiring agency. Then decided to quit, set up his own shop. By the time he was, I think, 21, he ran a financially successful agency, which he sold for a lot of money, and then managed to basically buy his own way into the entertainment industry. He became a casting director, then a producer, and then directed Shadowboxer, and became the Lee Daniels we know now, and gave the world Empire. So at least, you know, we can thank him for keeping Terrence Howard in... Terrence Howard in work. Yeah. You know, that's that.
Yeah. I like Empire. I kind of hate watch it.
I've never watched it.
It's definitely worth watching in the way that you would watch really, really trashy shows.
Isn't it just Raps Glee?
No. I mean, yeah, kind of.
Kind of.
A little bit.
Oh, okay. No, hang on. Isn't it Nashville with rap?
Yeah. It could. Yeah.
Basically Nashville for Rapsville, rap. Yeah.
Kind of.
Rapsville.
Yeah.
Rapsville. Okay, yeah. Right. Well, I'll be honest. I've only ever seen three episodes of New Girl, so my TV back catalogue.
I do think you need to catch up on New Girl.
Well, yeah, because otherwise I won't know, my Jake Johnson, and I won't understand you quite as well as I could. So yeah, there's that.
All of this fashion sense comes from Jake Johnson.
Is that what it is? Is that the explanation?
Yeah. All of the flannel shirts.
So let's talk about the Rachels for a second, because we've got Rachel McAdams, Rachel Weisz. They've got a project together coming up.
Oh really? Is Rachel Bloom going to be in it as well? She was the only other Rachel I could think of.
Well, yeah, there's possibly. That'd be awesome, yeah, casting.
She's cool. I like Richard Bloom.
Well, it's going to be called Disobedience. It's based on a novel by Naomi Alderman, which is a British novel set in London. So I don't know if this is going to do the whole girl on the train thing and transplant it.
Set it somewhere else, yeah.
It's going to... Rachel Weisz is also producing it. She's going to star as the lead, who is a lapsed Jew and a rabbi's daughter named Ronitz. She returns home to her Orthodox Jewish community when the rabbi father passes away. Having not been home for some time, she goes back and apparently is going to cause upheaval because her former best friend / unrequited love is now her cousin's wife, and the pair reignite their romance and basically cause all manner of chaos as a result, Rachel McAdams being the love interest.
Yeah.
So that one being
interesting. That sounds interesting.
Meanwhile, Chloe Moretz is going to join Tilda Swinton in a remake of Suspiria.
Wasn't she quitting acting a week ago?
Yeah, I think that might have been a case of I'll quit until you offer me something better.
Tilda Swinton.
Tilda Swinton? Where do I sign up? Which I'm pretty sure is how they got Benedict Cumberbatch to do a Marvel movie. Tilda Swinton, pass me the cape. Have you seen the latest Doctor...
Great impression.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Have you seen the latest Doctor Strange TV spot? The reverse one?
No, I've not. I've heard about it. I'm trying not to watch it because I watched one a couple of weeks ago.
Oh, there's no new footage in it.
It's just in reverse.
It's just in reverse. But cool. They've cleverly... Everything about it is in reverse, as in the logo comes at the beginning, rating Kevin comes at the end.
Yeah.
Even the tagline is in reverse, and it makes complete sense, because in reverse it reads, "His time is now." You're like, oh, that's brilliant! Oh. Okay, that kind of works. I'm excited about this now. Although it does...
Good marketing.
Does kind of annoyingly confirm the presence of a certain Marvel MacGuffin, but, you know, aside from that.
I think everyone just figured...
So we have got an Infinity Stone coming.
Shocker.
Which means there has to be one in Black Panther. What are we missing now?
We're missing two stones.
We're missing the Time Stone. That's Doctor Strange.
Yeah.
What's the other stone then?
What have we had?
We've had the Mind Stone. Do you know, I forget offhand.
You've got to look it up.
The stones don't reconcile between the comics and the movies, so...
Yeah, they've kind of taken their own path with it.
Yeah. I know there's a green stone that's yet to come, so...
So maybe that's Black Panther, because James Gunn said there's not going to be one in Guardians 2.
Doesn't need to be, though, does it?
And speaking of Guardians, segue into a tiny bit of news, which isn't really news, but it's kind of fun.
Go on.
Guardians of the Galaxy
has
the highest body count of any film.
Fantastic. Does that mean James Gunn has finally wiped out reality?
I think so. I'm going to try and find the exact number.
How many people died in The Force Awakens?
I'll try and find that. Save us on bliss. Do you know what? It's not even on the top 10. I will give you 5-1.
So okay, 5-1. Body count in films. Go on.
300 Rise of an Empire. 2,234.
Really?
Acceptable, okay.
Okay, fair enough.
Lord of the Rings, Return of the King.
Yeah.
2,798.
Right.
You can see that. Number 3, The Sum of All Fears.
Oh, God, yeah, they didn't need nukes. Yeah.
2,992.
They did wipe out the Super Bowl, to be fair.
22. Yeah, that's true, yeah. Mm. We definitely kick it up a notch for number 2. Dracula Untold. Do you remember that film? Luke Evans?
Vaguely, yeah.
Yeah.
Is that the one that maybe kind of sort of fits into the shared monsters universe?
But maybe, depending on how much Luke Evans is getting paid by Disney, so expect to see him play Namor anytime soon.
Yes.
Yeah.
Go on.
5,687.
That was a lot of carnage. That's
pretty good, yeah. Not too bad, respectable number.
Number 1.
Guardians of the Galaxy. 83,871.
The first one?
The first one, yeah.
How did 83,000 people die in Guardians of the Galaxy?
I need to go back and watch it, but I remember that...
Is it when the ship crashed onto Nova Planet?
Yeah, well, it'll be that. And isn't it like a flashback to when Drax's... Does something blow up in nowhere? Like a big planet blow up in nowhere?
No, I'm sure. I'm sure the only mass carnage situation is the necromancer-like ship crashing.
When it comes down?
Yeah.
I can't imagine that many people died.
83,000 people died in... Well, hang on, because that's nonsense, because in Star Wars A New Hope, Obi-Wan specifically said, like millions of voices were crying out, which means millions of people on Alderaan died.
Died, yeah.
And that's to say nothing of what was the population of the Death Star.
Justice for Alderaan.
Hashtag Alderaanian lives matter.
Yeah. Well, this is according to The Guardian. And The Guardian gave Swiss Army Man 1 star the other day, so I don't trust
it. Gave
them.
What?
Swiss Army Man. They gave it one star.
1 star?
Yeah.
Who was the reviewer?
Do
you know?
Wendy something.
Wendy Eyed.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Does that make sense to you?
I'm surprised at her. We usually agree.
Oh, well, never mind. Go tell her that her opinion is false.
I'm not going to say that to her,
but... You should.
No, she's a nice lady.
I'm sure she is. She's definitely entitled to her opinion, but her opinion is wrong.
She is. But she's a nice lady. I would never tell her she's wrong, but in this case, she's mistaken.
Which is just PC for wrong.
Okay, so let's talk about another thing that's very, very wrong then. Let's talk about the Greasy Strangler.
Yes.
Which...
I really want to see it.
Really?
Of course, yeah.
Stop. Stop wanting to see it. Which is the featured debut of Jim Hosking. It is the story of a an adult son and his father. You've got Big Ronnie, who's the dad, who's played by Michael St. Michael. And his son, Big Braden, who's played by, how do I say his name? Sky Elabar. And they present disco tours of the back streets of LA. Basically, it's made up nonsense. They just pick a doorway and say, "Oh, this is where the Bee Gees wrote Staying Alive" or "Night Fever." They make stuff up, and they're basically disgusting. You know, horrible people. You know, there's something of a John Waters / Napoleon Dynamite kind of tone to all this.
Yeah.
The father son relationship starts to break down when the son encounters a woman on the tour, on one of their tours, with whom he begins a relationship, and what then follows is a love triangle between the three. In the background of all of this is Big Ronnie's insistence that he is the notorious local Greasy Strangler, a man who butters himself head to toe every night in grease and trolls the streets of LA randomly killing people. Doesn't seemingly actually strangle them, so I'm not sure where the name comes from.
It's a good name. It's a good name.
We'll do the clip and then we'll talk about it.
I'm sorry. My dad can get cranky sometimes.
As your father, I forbid you to marry.
He sure has a temper on him.
Hey! Stop talking to the customer and help Dad with his shorts!
Janet loves me. I love her.
You're making a big mistake.
Jody needs to go now.
I am the Greasy Strangler.
Now, there is something incredibly 2016 about this film. And I say that given that it's imbued with a sort of 70s look to it, 70s inspired John Waters loving edge to it all. You can only release this in 2016 because this is a year where, let's be honest, you know, huge world events have been brought about by idiots simply pushing shock comments, for lack of a better term. I mean, one of them might actually be the next US president. So, you know, and you know, let's say, to say nothing of Brexit. That said, then, this fits in completely because this is a film so crass, vulgar, and uninteresting that it just feels completely at home in 2016. It really does. If ever a film summed up 2016, it is The Greasy Strangler. It is... I'm going to be fair to Jim Hosking for a moment and just say that it is an exercise in style over substance, and it is memorable. You know, you've got to give it... It's memorable for all the wrong reasons, but it's memorable. It is appallingly written, it's not funny, it's not interesting. I couldn't tell you if it was well acted because the characters are these pantomime creations that never really amount to much. It's a horrible, unpleasant, abhorrent experience that lasts something like 88 minutes. I was like, 93 minutes.
So it's not too long then, that's good.
No, it lasts 93 minutes, it feels about 3 weeks long. It is... Just the problem with it actually is it's all so uninteresting that you can't hate it. To hate it would involve mustering up any kind of enthusiasm for it. And yet it's so unengaging, so unengrossing that you can't. You come out of it afterwards and think, well, the repeated line gag doesn't work because there is just that back and forth payoff kind of callback kind of a gag style. That doesn't work. Visually didn't do an awful lot for me. Story was rubbish. Cast was rubbish. Didn't care.
Rubbish.
Didn't hate it. It was rubbish. Mm. And really, that's it. And you look at it, and because it has gotten really, really good write-ups. It's
yeah,
gotten
it really has.
Poster quotes. This is the thing. It's gotten poster quotes. Now, I'm always dubious about poster quotes when I've not seen the reviews. This is one of those films that feels like it's been entirely constructed to appeal solely to what I call pre-fans. And... pre-fans are the kind of people that still insist to this day that Batman Superman was any cop, when we all know it really wasn't. They are people that love something in theory. Before sight unseen, love it in theory. That have a preconceived notion which they can't then shake. They can never move past the preconceived notion to actually fairly judge something. So they just insist that it's, you know, what they already thought it was, regardless of whether or not it's the complete polar opposite. Mm. This is one of those films. It's a film that has generated pre-fans through a quirky trailer. And those fans really, really need to admit that no, not a chance, and in that order. This is... the worst. This is awful. This is just dreadful. It should never be seen by another person. It is just bad. You come out of it afterwards and you just have this dull headache, this dull pain in your frontal cortex, this overwhelming dilemma whereby you really want to debate whether or not the feeling of nausea that's overpowering you is due to having spent 93 minutes looking at congealed fat, or if it's just a result of the film itself. But at the same time, to actually give it that much discussion would be doing it a service it doesn't deserve. It is bad in every... I know you're interested in it. I can only tell you, you have seen the best of it.
I think my interest stemmed from the fact that it didn't look that great.
It's not that great. It really isn't.
I like a film that just looks terrible.
You like a bit of crap.
I've never seen before. That's kind of where my interest stemmed from it.
But then again,
I could start watching it and then 20 minutes in so much, but like, this is just not even...
You say
bad
that, though, about things
it,
you've
just...
never seen before.
Yeah.
You have, though. You've seen it done infinitely better in John Waters movies. Just watch a John Waters film.
I want to see more.
Rewatch them.
Okay.
Just rewatch some John Waters films. You'll see this done better. And it's just not any good. It's impossible to like. It's impossible to get on board with. You're not interested enough to even vaguely try following it. It's just a waste of time. So, sorry to destroy that for you. By the way, I've just noticed your phone wallpaper.
Destroyed anything?
Yeah, I've just noticed your phone wallpaper. And yeah. Brie Larson.
Mm, yeah.
Somebody
saw this on my phone the other day and thought that it was my daughter. Unmistakably.
Is it because she's in a Captain Marvel hoodie?
Yeah, and then I had to awkwardly then explain that no, it's an actress I really like who's going to be playing a superhero I really like, and it was really awkward.
I discovered the other day that Brie Larson used to be a pop singer.
Yes, she did.
I did not know this.
Yeah, she can carry a tune.
She can carry a tune. I can't imagine her singing.
You're not.
Well, I mean, she does in Room briefly, doesn't she?
Yeah, briefly.
But no,
she
can't.
No, yeah, she had something of a career. She is. I think she's married now. To the guy from Phantom Planet who did the soundtrack to the OC.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. So I saw him at the Oscars and I was like, what?
Why is California dude there? Because that's all he is to us.
That's all he is.
He's California dude. What else we got in the film news then this week?
I got some news about Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So
the ones who didn't do the score to The Girl on the Train.
The ones that didn't do the score to Girl Train, but did do
Gone Girl.
To Gone Girl and Social Network and
yes.
Girl with Dragon Tattoo.
Oh, they did, didn't they? Yeah, I remember that now.
So those, I believe, are the only feature films they've done the score to.
And they should do more because
they are
awesome.
They are.
What are they doing,
Chris? Not a David Fincher film.
No.
A Peter Berg film.
Oh, no. Is it Patriots Day?
It is Patriots Day.
Oh, okay.
Which I... Yeah, I wasn't really looking forward to it until I heard that, and then I looked more into the film. I mean, obviously, I knew what it was about, but I didn't know who was in the cast, who was involved. I knew that my man Marky Mark was there, because Peter Berg. I knew John Goodman was there.
Yeah.
Usually John Goodman will sell me on any film.
That's true.
It's John Goodman. But Kevin Bacon,
mm-hmm.
J.K. Simmons.
Yep.
There's someone else as well, but I've forgotten, but equally as good.
Mm-hmm.
What's the name? Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Oh, Michelle Monaghan.
Yeah, Michelle Monaghan's in it. Yeah, and now Trent Reznor and Atticus Ross.
So you're
pretty interesting.
Going to gloss over the fact that Supergirl's in it. Just
and Melissa Benoist, that was the other one as well.
Actually, we looked this up the other day. I was in the Cineworld Leicester Square, which nobody is calling it that. Nobody,
the Empire.
Nobody is calling it the Cineworld Leicester Square. It is the Empire Leicester Square. It's even written on the glass. I was chatting to some of the staff there. I was stood around talking to Alan. And these two guys, and we were talking about, because it was before Deepwater Horizon.
Yeah.
And we were talking about it being Peter Berg's next film, being Patriots Day, and we couldn't figure out how you're supposed to pronounce her name. It's Melissa Benoist.
Benoist. Why have I always said Benoist?
I've always said Benoist. It's Benoist. Which,
Benoist.
The only problem with saying Melissa Benoist is, what do you think of? Noice.
I wasn't going to say that. I was going to say that it rhymed with moist, which isn't
let's
isn't
not go
as
there.
Good.
Let's not. But no, noice. I always think of noice in Key and Peele. But yeah, she's a Supergirl. Supergirl's getting a movie.
Oh my God, I've heard of Jordan Peele's new film.
Get Out?
Get Out, yeah. The trailer dropped for the other day.
I haven't had the pleasure yet.
It looks pretty good. It looks promising.
I haven't seen the Pirates of the Caribbean one either, so... Have you not?
That looks promising. I shouldn't say it.
Really?
Yeah.
Pirates 5 looks promising?
I know. Hey, we're living in a world where Fast and Furious 8 is currently in post-production. Anything is possible.
It's true. Although I go with the John Oliver thing.
If somebody's
Pirates of the Caribbean 5, did anyone really ask this?
Yeah. But if someone had said to me, like, after the second Fast film...
If someone said to me we'd have seven Saw movies, I never would have believed you.
Exactly, yeah.
But speaking of a bit of casting news we had last week, it was a rumour last week, has now come to fruition. Murder on the Orient Express.
Oh my God, yeah. This cast is so good. Hell of a cast.
Wow. So Kenny Branagh's...
K-Bray.
Yeah, K-Bray is directing and starring as Hercule Poirot. And your boy Herc. And... And as these passengers on the Orient Express, we're going to have Judi Dench. We're going to have Derek Jacobi. We're going to have Daisy Ridley.
Can I just say, of course Derek Jacobi is going to be
there. Of course he is.
Of course he is.
I almost would like push for Toby Jones, except he did the TV version with David Suchet.
Yes, he did, yeah.
You're also going to have Michelle Pfeiffer and Johnny Depp as Mr. Ratchet. He apparently is the last holdout. They want him for Mr. Ratchet. And this is the part that I find more amusing than anything. They apparently have swapped out one of the characters and written in a new one, who is going to be a Cuban character played by Mr. Michael Peña, y'all.
Yes.
Oh, my God, that's awesome.
So good.
Oh.
Did you say with Daisy Ridley as well?
Ridley.
Yeah. It's... Excellent.
So they say there's been like a murder on the Orient Express, and I'm like, yeah.
And also, Leslie Odom Jr.
Oh, that's the one.
From Hamilton.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's playing the one that Daisy Ridley fancies.
Yeah, Dr. Constantine.
That's it. Thank you. I can't remember the name of the character.
I don't know if his first name is John. We'll see.
Speaking of, Keanu Reeves apparently is debuting some footage this weekend from John Wick 2.
Oh, really? Oh, so, at New York Comic Con.
Yeah, which means there's going to be a Power Rangers trailer, hopefully. Well, we might get the John Wick trailer as well.
I think we will. We had the poster. Do we have the poster job? Yes,
we had the poster.
John Wick, yeah. And we had a picture of him and his new dog.
We did. Have you seen the tagline for the poster, by the way?
No.
Bulletproof. I'm so happy.
I can't wait.
I really can't wait. I'm just happy Ian McShane's coming back for John Wick Chapter 2. That makes me happy.
I saw a really terrible tagline earlier for a film called Sleepless that's coming out. Jamie Foxx.
Oh, I've seen an image from it. What's the tagline?
Oh, I'm going to try and find out, is it?
Oh, all right. Go on.
He's a cop in a world of dirty cops.
Yeah.
He's an undercover cop.
Okay.
The tagline is, don't judge a cop by his cover. So good.
Was it the man with the iron fist that says they put the F-U in
Kung Fu? F-U in Kung Fu, that is my favourite tagline of any film.
So good.
So good.
Oh, man. We've got some bad news, though, for someone we both quite like, I think, which is poor Terry Gilliam. And
oh, my God, yeah.
This ongoing saga of the man who killed Don Quixote has been delayed again because apparently, as he puts it, a Portuguese chap who promised him the funding has welched.
Was this just some guy he met in a bar?
Yeah.
And he was just like, I'll give you some
money. Do you know what? I think after all these years, Terry Gilliam just got to that stage where he's just meeting people and was like, look, can I have some money for a film, please? I know you're good for it. Just help me make this movie. Mm. And yeah, so poor Adam Driver and Michael Palin just sat around. Yeah. And Michael Palin's got stuff, you know, on his mind.
Yes, he does. Yeah.
So, yeah.
That sucks.
All right. I'll give you another bit of film news then about my favourite movie star of the week, Mr. Gibson. He signed up for a film by Benjamin Roche called Every Other Weekend. He is going to play the grandfather in a multi-generational action-adventure comedy. Right, the idea
it's
is...
not too many of them.
No. So the idea is the father has claimed he is a CIA agent when in reality he's the tech support guy. He's the IT man. He takes his son on a father-son trip to Paris, and there's a whole accidental spy riff. They find themselves on the run from terrorists. Mel Gibson is going to play the grandfather, who, get this, is an actual CIA agent. So this could be quite fun.
Yeah.
I feel like that's going to be one of those, hey, star power kind of cameo kind of a roles.
Yeah.
You know, like Statham in Spy kind of a thing.
Yeah.
Like that with Gibson.
It's like, can you believe that we got this person?
Yeah, that kind of a thing. I feel like that's kind of what happens.
Yeah.
So final review of the week then. Let's talk about The Guv'nor, which is Paul Van Carter's documentary about the life of Lenny McLean. Lenny McLean.
I don't know who he is, so I can't possibly
You
comment.
Do actually, believe it or not. Remember Lock, Stock and Two Smoking Barrels?
I do, I like the film a lot.
He's Barry the Baptist.
No way, really?
Yeah. If you don't want to be counting fingers, you haven't got. I suggest you get those guns. Sharpish.
As good as an impression that is, yeah, that could have just been Ray Winston.
Could have been, couldn't it? Could have been. Really could have been. But that was his voice. So this is a documentary that follows around his son, Jamie, his only son, as he basically chronicles his dad's life and tries to get to know the man behind the name, really. Just takes us from Lenny McLean's, you know, his humble origins to, you know, becoming the Guv’nor, a.k.a. the hardest man in Britain. We have a clip.
I'm the Guv’nor!
If you can imagine a pot of boiling water and it's always simmering, it's ready to boil.
Lenny McLean is like a dog. He's going to come back and bite you.
He got involved in unlicensed boxing, thinking I might as well go straight to the top.
Roy Shaw, he was certified insane. Lenny, crash bang wallop.
That's why they call me Daddy Cole. Look at me.
So, third documentary out this week. So there's, you know, noticeably not a lack of documentary materials out there. The problem is, you know, when you've got things like, we live in a, you know, post-Senna, post-Amy, post, you know, Adam Curtis kind of a world. We're used to stylized documentaries. Here is a Channel 5 documentary, and it doesn't amount to an awful lot more than it. The problem is, the material simply isn't there. Like, the film takes a stand very early on about, you know, Lenny McLean, that he, you know, he's on the side of the angels, even though, you know, acting like the devil to do it. The stuff in there that they get Guy Ritchie at one point, for instance, talk to Jason Fleming. Jason Fleming instantly tells the single greatest story about Lenny McLean. They shared a trailer, did you know, when filming
Lock Stock.
Yeah. And it does lead to a moment of intimidation that you just kind of love. First of all, it's not directed with any more ambition than the idea of a Channel 5 documentary. The material simply isn't there. The depth that it should go into in terms of really getting under the skin of its subject, it seems quite afraid to. It's got this awful, awful score to it all that is just, it's like it's dedicated to drowning out everyone speaking. At one point, Vaz Blackwood from Lock Stock turns up. Rory Breaker from Lock Stock, remember with the crazy afro?
Yeah.
That actor turns up and you can't hear a word he said because the score is just drowning him out entirely. I have no idea what he said. He had a smile on his face, so I assume it was positive. But I, you know, for all I know,
decide for what it was.
Yeah, for all I know, Lenny McLean beat him up for his PIN number. But I wouldn't know that because I couldn't hear a word the man said. It's one of those films that you just sit and think, we've got a fictionalized version of this coming out next year. You know, Josh Hellman from X-Men.
I do.
Plays Stryker. He's playing Lenny McLean in an actual biopic.
Okay.
And you come out and think, that's got to have more depth to it than this does.
Yeah, because, more interesting.
Yeah. Why not just wait for it? Just wait for that. I mean, this is, you know, very limited theatrical release.
And
he does look like him. He looks like him when he's younger. Fascinating bit of sort of, you know, quirky twist of fate for you. One of Lenny McLean's sort of initial, you know, moments of the limelight, he fought Roy Shaw in an unlicensed boxing match. They're actually now, as of this week, making a biopic about him.
Cool.
So, yeah, quirky thing. We're going to get both fighters are going to have biopics in the next couple of years.
That'd be a good double bill when they're out as well.
Would be as well, wouldn't it? Because that same fight, well, you know what they should do? Just get Josh Hellman to cameo as Lenny McLean and have it be like an intersection crossover point for the pair. That would be quite clever.
That'd be great, yeah.
You know, it's like when Jason Statham turns up at the beginning of Collateral and you think, wait, he's dressed as he is in Cellular, so these movies happen in the same world.
I forgot he was even in that.
As the Cellular character.
Yeah.
So yeah, the character.
Shared universes, man.
I'm not sure if Cellular's meant to have... No, Cellular happens after Collateral.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, kind of interesting. But I didn't rate it, you know? I really didn't.
Yeah.
I feel like...
It's interesting subject matter, just not good
execution. Yeah, I feel like he needed better for that.
Yeah.
Angelina Jolie's doing a true story movie. She's actually going to star in her first sort of action-centric movie for 6 years.
Salt? Was that?
Since Salt and... What was the other one? There was Salt and something else that year, and I can't remember offhand.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's going to be called Shoot Like a Girl.
Cool. Good title.
It is, yes, and it's based on the memoir of the same name. I forget the name of the helicopter pilot who served in the US Armed Forces and was instrumental in bringing about a change of military policy so that women were actually allowed to serve on the front line.
Wow.
And she's going to be AJ,
cool.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting. Zac Efron is going to star in and produce a movie called Straight to Hell. Do you know what this is about? Straight to Hell is a it's based on a novel of the same name that was written about the bankers of Goldman Sachs, right? And it was based entirely on conversations overheard in their elevator.
Wow.
And yeah, so when the book came out, Goldman Sachs apparently were absolutely outraged and actually began an investigation into how did this information get leaked?
Yeah.
Who's been hanging around in our lifts? And yeah, so expect something kind of akin to Wolf of Wall Street, like that, with Zac Efron.
That's not a bad thing.
I could see that working.
I could totally see that, yeah.
Yeah.
So would he sort of be playing a Jordan Belforty type?
I hope so. I really hope so. That would be awesome.
That'd be good to see. Yeah.
Yeah, I'd be intrigued by that.
Yeah.
You got anything else for me over there?
Yeah, a couple of pieces. Nothing huge, but Ocean's 8.
Oh, Ocean's 8 has a release date.
It's got a release date. Yeah, the 8th of June 2018, which seems quite a ways away.
The 8th of June 2018.
Yeah.
Okay, so they're going with the 8. Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Hang on, they're calling it Ocean's 8 now, not Ocean's Ocho anymore.
Exactly.
Okay, fair enough. I'll go with that. That's fine.
Maybe it's going to get bumped into August as well, so it's just 8th of the 8th, 18.
Gavin O'Connor, the director of Warrior.
Yeah.
Apparently he said, we've got ideas for a sequel. I've been talking to Tom Hardy and Joel Edgerton about them. It might happen.
I think that might be something that goes to Netflix, because he's just got a show commission with Netflix. I can't remember what it's called, but he's doing something with Netflix. Netflix are getting all the best filmmakers.
They really are, aren't they?
Yeah, I still need to watch that Joe Swanberg show.
Oh, Easy.
Easy, yeah. I still need to check it out.
It was very interesting. Bizarrely, the Orlando Bloom episode turned out to be the better one. But
who'd have thunk it?
I know, who'd have thunk it? Something with Orlando Bloom in was actually half decent.
I know, and he's going back in Pirates 5, so maybe it's not going to be.
Oh, no, is he?
He is.
I've forgotten that.
He is indeed. But Javier Bardem is playing a spooky ghost, so...
You know what? I can totally live with it.
I'm sold on Spooky Ghost Bardem.
See, that's what we need. We need Javier Bardem as a Scooby-Doo villain. That's the ultimate thing, right there.
Can you imagine someone taking off his face?
The take off his face, it's Michael Shannon underneath, grimacing.
And then it's Benicio Del Toro.
Exactly. It's just increasingly grimacing guys underneath, one at a time. But there's a moment, by the way, in Bloodfather. That made me... It got a weird laugh in the cinema. It was very strange. They're being hunted by a hitman. And Mel Gibson says, oh, that guy, he's a Sicario. Everybody laughed! That movie has scarred us all.
And you all were just like, get that.
Yeah, it's one of those things. But I'm glad Mel Gibson's back. You know, if Mad Max is back, we can have Mel Gibson back. That's how I feel about it. Hey, but
I'll wait until I see this film, then Ben Hacksaw Ridge... And then wait until he, like, hugs a rabbi, and then I might feel better.
I don't think any rabbi's ever letting Mel Gibson hug them, but...
Maybe a handshake.
And you know what? We should be grateful to Mel Gibson for one thing, because even in his darkest hour, he was still thinking of us. You know how I know that? Oh. Because he gave us the term sugar s***. Only a man with a pure heart would do that to us.
Sugar s*** definitely was around before he came up with
it. I'm sure it was around, but he popularised it. It's like conscious uncoupling. I'm sure it was around before, but we owe Gwyneth for giving us that
little
gem.
I think you have to be a certain... specimen of up your own arseness, like Gwyneth Paltrow, to come up with that term. Conscious uncoupling.
Isn't she one of John Oliver's favourite targets?
Yeah.
He's going, and I'm looking at you, Gwyneth.
Oh, just, have you seen the clip of when she wins an Oscar?
No. I have not.
She's crying and babbling and stuff. And she's thanking everyone, and then the camera pans to her mum, Blythe Danner, and Blythe Danner's like, I brought you into the world. What was I doing with my vagina? Why did I let you come into the world? Like, she looks genuinely ashamed to be a mom.
We still haven't quite solved the mystery, by the way, of whether or not Jake Paltrow, who's one of the directors of De Palma, is Gwyneth's...
Yes.
Is
yes.
he?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Is Gwyneth's brother?
Brother.
Ah, fair enough. Yeah. Okay, well, mystery solved. On which note, here it is, your moment of cage.
I have been searching a very long time. Magically, here you are. That ring on your finger means something, Dave. It means you're going to be a very important sorcerer one day. And your first lesson begins right now with your very own Incantus. Do not move, do not touch anything.